Are you planning to make another episode? Well, by the way, we ran out of the cat food.
Welcome to our laboratory of the endless exploration of Chernobyl technologies. So today we have for you Robotron 1715M, which is nearly 40 years old German-made computer. And exactly the same machines, after 1986, were involved in quite important works in the Chernobyl exclusion zone, which we also will talk about today. Well, from those very computers remained nothing apart from some mentioning in scientific documents and also just rusty junk across Pripyat. But this one is fully functional, because it came to us from Software and Computer Museum based here in Ukraine, in Kharkiv. So let's take a detailed look at it and make a test run. And a full version of this episode and bonus reading you can find on our Patreon page. The link is in the description below. So this machine was designed in 1984 and is based on a German clone of Zilog Z80 processor. It was produced in two variations up to 1989 by Fab Robotron. It was the biggest East German producer of electronics, which included a lot of factories making mainframes, minicomputers, personal workstations and much more. All that was a part of a Comic-Con cooperation involving all the socialistic bloc, so various Robotron equipment was also exported to the USSR as well. Despite its sturdy, somewhat industrial look, everything is very well built and using high-quality materials. Both models, 1715 and 1715M, look the same from outside. In front there is a power switch, and above is a vent, and on another side is reset button. There are two 800 kilobyte 5-inch floppy disk drives, and there is no hard disk, no mouse, and no sound. The actual differences were inside. The processor of the earlier 1715 model operated on a frequency 2.5 MHz, and that machine had 64 kilobytes of RAM. And this model already had 4.7 MHz processor, and RAM you could expand up to 256 kilobytes. The display is monochrome green and supports only a text mode with some pseudo graphics. It can output either 16 rows to 64 or 24 rows to 80 symbols. The display has a cubic shaped full metal enclosure made in the same style as the computer, and it has this powerful stand which allows to tilt it. There are no switches on it, just two cables which you plug into the machine. And speaking about cabling and ports, this is what we have on the back. It is visible that they actually paid attention to prevent some user mistakes, so all connectors are shape-coded, so you could not plug them wrong. On the left side, there is a standard power plug, two fuses and a power connector for the display. They equipped it with this lock, so it holds really well. Then, on the right, we have a display signal connector, an IFSS port for a printer and a V24 interface port. There is also this port, and given that machine has quite poor storage capabilities, they are allowed to connect an external drive, either 5 or 8 inch. But as you probably noticed, there is no keyboard connector, because it is located on the left side of the computer, and the cable itself is quite short. The keyboard is made of metal, it's really heavy and, have to say, quite interesting. In fact, it is a standalone computer made on the same UA880 processor as the main unit. It has notably many functional buttons, and the manual explains their purpose quite well, but there is also a notice that it may vary on the operation system used. There are also notably many cursor-pointing buttons, and actually in action it appeared to be quite convenient. And also there is this button equipped with LED, so this button is quite interesting because it allows to switch the character set used, not only for the input, but also for the interface. And the problem with this keyboard is that the input layout for Latin is not QWERTY, but Itsuken. Well, basically, Latin letters match the Cyrillic. Well, this you actually could adapt, as vast majority of computers for USSR used exactly that. But the bigger problem is the design of the buttons themselves. I mean, they are very well built, each of them has two springs and a special movable part inside, and while it makes them really reliable, you in fact need to position your finger right in the middle to press them, so typing is really not easy. So, speaking about how these computers were used in the Chernobyl exclusion zone, actually I could find pretty much information in old scientific publications from the 80s. I even translated some fragments to English, so if you wish, find them on our Patreon page. But let's take a brief look to some user cases. For example, Robotron 1715 were used to process aggregated data on radiation surveys gathered by airborne laboratories which were flying above Ukraine and Belarus. But bigger work they got at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, where they became an integral part of the very first RDC system of the radiation monitoring and self-diagnostics of the new built sarcophagus of the Unit 4. That system consisted of 5 subsystems, each of 10 neutron flux detectors installed in the drills to reach the inaccessible places, each connected to the special processing unit. And those in their turn were wired to a special custom-designed UH-13R control panel. From this panel came a set of communication cables, one connected to a SM-1420 Soviet PDP-11 clone minicomputer, which made a mathematical analysis of the behavior of high radioactive materials. By the way, in the next 2 weeks we are going to have an episode about those machines as well, don't miss it. Another set of communication cables came to a Robotron 1715M computer, so it presented the live data from a chosen channel to operator, also the data for each control point with details about detector and room it was installed in, as well as comparison with the set points and historical information. And finally, in this system, Robotron computers controlled so-called blankers of detectors. So the blanker is basically a check source, which has a rotary lead that gets triggered open by some electric signal. And that thing allows to calibrate the detector without any need to take them out from, say, a room where this detector is operating. One more place where Robotron computers were used in variety was at Jupiter factory in Pripyat, and at the former Spetsatom experimental facilities you can find parts of those computers all across the administration building. They were widely used there for engineering works, and actually a few of them even controlled some robots. And now let's try this system in action, and the differences from any modern PCs start right after we toggle the power switch on. So, as you can see, there is no image on the display, and it will appear only after the boot sequence is complete. And for now, the computer will continuously check the drives until we insert the system disk. A native operation system for this computer is called SCP, and it is just a clone of CPM. But we will use TOS/M, which is a localized version based on the SCP 3.0, where character sets are dynamically loaded by software commands. I wonder to which class this SCP belongs to. Other than that, it is just a CPM by functionality. There existed some software, of course, such as a Ref4, which was a clone of WordStar text editor. Well, we have here only the original WordStar. Then there was Veritab, which is a cloned SuperCalc table processor, and for databases there was opcode Rebus, which was quite a good adaptation of DBase to database system. Well, I'll be honest with you, to do something using this keyboard is really that hard, that instead I suggest to try something truly iconic. So our friends from the museum gave us a disc with games, and here we'll try to play Tetris. To my mind, this version of Tetris looks really, really close to the very original developed by Alexei Pozhitnov on Electronica 60 industrial computer. There it is. Well, it's so cool actually. This is so cool. Okay, the full gameplay you will see in our Patreon version, but let's see something more for now. So, one more game which pretty much impressed me is a 3D labyrinth. So that actually looks quite cool, because it's all made with pseudographic elements. and you can navigate all around it using just the keyboard. Well, just look at this. This is so cool. Okay, we also have this disc, but somewhat it doesn't work here. Speaking about the Charset switching, a quick example for you. So, on another disc we have a Sprint table processor. And if you start it and say open the help page, we're gonna see here a Cyrillic text in waiting transliteration. But if I press that SISO button, it changes everything to native Cyrillic, and vice versa. Well, so to my mind, even despite some limitations and objective design issues that are here, this machine is much better than anything that Soviets produced for consumer market. Well, those who are along with us will of course recall how 2 years ago we looked inside the 286-based Robotron and have to say that was a real headache. But here the design is much better. So to open it is enough to just slide and pull away the upper part of the casing. And this is it. There is a very huge power supply equipped with a huge 220 volt fan, and we can see the graphic controller card, and below is the motherboard. Almost no cables, everything is very accessible and straightforward. The drives are mounted on this thick metal tray, and they are connected with the ribbon cable equipped with those little adapter boards. That's what they look like. And to take it all out, all we need is turn those two screws. And once we remove it, here we have a motherboard, and we can see a large set of microchips that form the RAM bank. Well, frankly speaking, with those red capacitors, this motherboard looks like a look from a plane to a communist demonstration in the panel district. Above the motherboard is the graphics controller, and it's secured by 3 screws, and the connector is positioned between, so it is all is like a sandwich. The controller is based on the KR580 VG75 chip, which is a clone of Intel 8275. And once we removed the controller, this is the motherboard. What a surprise, I actually expected to see here the German clone of Z80, but there is one from ST Microelectronics. And above is DMA controller, and below is the programmable controller for serial interface. Well, those two actually made in Germany. And below is the floppy disk controller, which technically is Intel 8272. There also existed a German clone of it, but it is not here. Well, apart from that, there are also plenty of Soviet and some Czechoslovak chips. What a mixture. So, such a nice little machine. Well, as for me, it's a little bit too limited in its capabilities, mostly because of lack of the graphic mode for some, you know, meaningful retro computing, but nevertheless, I pretty much liked it. So, the full version of this video find on our Patreon page along with some bonus reading. And that's it for today. See you next time.